The side effect profile of Hiprex is way, way lower than for antibiotics. It's actually very rare for people to produce side effects with Hiprex.
Are there any antibiotics that should not be taken with Hiprex?
Sulfonamides. Okay, so okay. Not prescribed very much in the UK, but in the USA, there's a medication called co-trimoxazole, which is a combination of trimethoprim and a sulfonamide. It goes by the brand names of Septum, Bactrim, Monotrim, and you must not go on Hiprex if you're on this antibiotic medication. Other than that, it combines really, really well with medications. I find that in particular, it combines incredibly well with nitrofurantoin prophylaxis, which funnily enough also performs optimally in an acidic environment. The majority of antibiotics do work better in acidic environments. Okay. Ciprofloxacin needs an acidic environment. If you have an alkaline urine when you're taking ciprofloxacin, you're actually going to precipitate out the antibiotic. You're going to get phosphate crystals. It's not okay. Good.
That leads in well to the question around why people are often advised to take vitamin C with Hiprex. One of the questions around that is, does it need to be in the form of ascorbic acid, or can it be a buffered vitamin C that has other ingredients in it?
Okay, all righty. So it is going to be better if it's a non-buffered vitamin C. Mm-hmm. So, and absolutely, people who struggle to naturally have a urine with a pH 6 or below are going to struggle to activate their Hiprex molecule in the urine. There are medications that you can get, over-the-counter medications. So I've got one here actually to show, this one called pH Down, which, is it pH Down? No, yes it is, pH Down. It decreases urinary pH by lit control and distributed via Purple Orchid in the UK. I'm not sure if it's available in the USA. I think it costs about 15 quid a month. And it's quite successful at reducing the pH. On the ingredients, it says we've got L-methionine, phytin, vitamin A, and zinc. So patients also can get hold of these supplements separately. If they, I don't know if they're expensive, but maybe you can get them cheaply from shops or online to combine those ingredients and bring their urinary pH down. The optimal level to get below is pH 5.75. If you can get your urine below that level, if you're at pH 5.5 or 5, you're just going to get more bang for your buck out your Hiprex.
Do you recommend that patients actually use test strips to monitor their pH to see?
I absolutely do. We always, when we process patient samples, do a chemical analysis as well as our microscopy analysis, our standard cultures and our extended cultures, including broth cultures. And we always pay close attention to their urinary pH. But we have to bear in mind that if they send us samples that are infected with organisms that artificially raise the pH, that it might not be the normal situation. But we're more than happy to actually process patient samples and advise on pH at a hugely reduced cost. We only charge a couple of quid for doing that.
Okay. If you're taking vitamin C for that purpose, do you need to take it at the same time as you take Hiprex, or can you take it at any stage throughout the day?
You can take it at any stage, to be honest, but vitamin C does pass through the urinary tract fairly rapidly. So I would say split up your doses. So I commonly say to the patients, you know, when you get up in the morning and you're going to be taking your Hiprex, take your vitamin C at a similar time to it. Maybe take your vitamin C before your breakfast, and then take your Hiprex after your breakfast. So there's food in the stomach, so it's not sitting on an empty stomach, because you're going to reduce your chances of getting acid indigestion type symptoms if there's something for it to rest on. And there's no indication that, you know, having food there, you know, reduces the bioavailability of Hiprex. So yeah, I think that's a good regime. So vitamin C, breakfast, then Hiprex. And of course, you're taking it again in the evening, and you can do that again in the evening. You can have vitamin C, you know, before your evening meal or before your supper, and then have you know, have something to eat, or just take your Hiprex straight after, depending on how you feel.
Okay. Is it okay to take Hiprex with non-antibiotic therapies or treatments such as estrogen or PACs or D-mannose or any other supplements?
It's absolutely fine. It doesn't seem to have an interaction apart from grapefruit.
Okay.
So don't take Hiprex and grapefruit at the same time. So, and I know that grapefruit seed extract is something that people commonly take for reducing bacterial load in the urine in problematic urinary tract infection cases. Mm-hmm. So although the grapefruit seed is slightly different to the grapefruit itself, I wouldn't risk it. No studies have been done on that, but we do know that there is the potential for interaction.
Okay, that's very helpful to know. What about probiotics? Should you space those apart from taking Hiprex, or do you think that isn't an issue?
I would, actually. Yes, I would. So Hiprex is pretty readily absorbed. So mm-hmm. I would take your probiotics, just at a different time of day. So maybe if you're taking your Hiprex morning and night, you take your probiotics in the middle of the day. I would leave at least an hour after taking your Hiprex before you take your probiotic. Mm-hmm. Definitely. Okay. Because you know, if we get some dissociation in the stomach and the probiotic is present in the stomach, and let's face it, they're expensive, the good ones mm-hmm. anyway. You just don't want to be killing off your expensive probiotic and abrogating its usefulness.
Yeah. There was a lot of questions around whether you can ever stop taking Hiprex and how you would know when it is safe to try that.
Okay. Obviously, that's almost like asking how long is a piece of string, mm-hmm. Because everybody is different in terms of when they can so safely stop taking it. We do know that Hiprex can be taken for years. It can be taken long term without problem. And indeed, we have got patients that have been on it for years without issue. Mm-hmm. The animal studies, they gave small animals Hiprex for up to 2-3 years and had no problems, no adverse effects. So I don't see a problem with this long term. And sometimes it's in medicine, it's a case of weighing up, risk analysis. And it's far more risky to have a really bad UTI than to be on Hiprex long term. I certainly prefer to be giving Hiprex long term than be giving antibiotics long term. Mm-hmm. We do know that the longer that an antibiotic is given, the more chance that we have of engendering antibiotic resistance and damage to the microbiome. And also, you know, maybe even antibiotics that don't really affect the microbiome, things such as nitrofurantoin, we've got long-term usage issues with lung problems, liver mm-hmm. problems, things like this. Obviously, this isn't to everyone, but, we've got to consider, population risk.
Mm-hmm. That's a good time to move on to some of the potential side effects or questions around that. And you mentioned that Hiprex is known to be effective against most bacteria, but does that mean that it will also be killing the good bacteria in the bladder and could cause a dysbiosis?
Now, that's a very interesting question. And the research work has not been done around that. But one would guess that, yes, Hiprex could probably kill the healthy bacteria in the bladder mm-hmm. as well, because it is active against all species. But interestingly, you touching on this, we are just about to do a little bit of work on this, right, where we're going to be sending urine for very very comprehensive testing along mm-hmm. those lines, using molecular technology testing, looking at cultures, standard cultures, extended cultures, and also using some of the more advanced spectrophotometric techniques for identifying bacteria in specimens. So we will update you on the data from that when all those tests are complete. And we're going to be doing that with patients who are symptomatic, urinary tract infection patients who are well maintained on Hiprex and no symptoms. Mm-hmm. And we haven't yet found a placebo arm, but we are trying to recruit a placebo arm, somebody who doesn't get UTIs, never had a UTI, taking a dose of Hiprex and seeing what it does to their urinary microbiome.
Yeah, we'll be very interested to see the results of that. Could Hiprex cause vaginal dryness or aching?
It should do, no. Hiprex has been reported rarely to cause itching. But it actually, the side effect profile of Hiprex is way, way lower than for antibiotics. It's actually very rare for people to produce side effects with Hiprex. But I have never heard of people talking about vaginal aching and dryness. It's much more common that vaginal aching and dryness is coincidental and down to another cause. And I would advise that in that case, the patient see their doctor and address other causes, obviously dependent on the patient's age. Are they perimenopausal? Or even if they're young, are they running into, you know, a premature menopause? Is it because the infection in their bladder isn't fully controlled? Because we know that bladder symptoms can refer through to the vagina.
Mm-hmm. Another person asked whether muscle pain, nerve pain, or bone pain could be attributed to Hiprex because the onset of the symptoms seem to associate with that.
Okay, so there isn't anything written up about this, but absolutely, if the drug is taken away and the symptoms improve and then reintroduced and the symptoms come back, this needs to be what we call yellow carded. So this needs to be reported to the doctor that prescribed the Hiprex and certainly to the company that produced the Hiprex, because this needs to be flagged up and popped into the data about the drug.
Okay, that's good advice. Could Hiprex cause calcification in the bladder?
Okay, so again, we haven't got the data to say that it does or it doesn't, but I've got a lot of experience with patients that are taking Hiprex, and I would say so far, no, I haven't seen this particularly. We know that taking certain things like vitamin D and vitamin C can lead to higher rates of production of calcium oxalate stones, no, I haven't seen any association with Hiprex.
Okay. And there's often concern raised around the fact that it forms formaldehyde in the bladder and whether this could be associated with an increased risk of cancer. Have you seen any studies that look into this?
No, I haven't seen any studies that look into this, but I would, again, reassure patients that the bladder is a hollow organ that is designed to house waste products, the body's waste products, and, you know, quite a number of molecules that, you know, wouldn't sit happily in other compartments in the body. It's incredibly resilient, although patients with symptoms would probably say, oh, it doesn't feel like it, but it is. And and we have just got so much experience with Hiprex. Like we say, it's been available, you know, over 100 years. We've never seen an association pop up with bladder cancers or damage to the bladder with use of Hiprex, even using it 3 times a day. So I would say pretty confidently that a drug that's been around that long and is used as much as Hiprex, surely the data would have presented itself before now.
For people that are on long-term treatment with antibiotics or Hiprex, do you think it's worth doing regular cystoscopy or any other kind of testing just to check whether things are still okay?
Okay, so I think really cystoscopy is quite an invasive procedure, diagnostic procedure, and there's lots of factors to be taken into account. So for anyone who is symptomatic and maybe has blood in the urine hematuria, and they are an older patient over the age of 40, it's always important to rule out a sinister pathology such as a malignancy, a cancer. But in terms of a patient who is having long-term Hiprex or long-term antibiotic in Hiprex, and their symptoms are fairly well under control, no, I would say not. You know, if it's not broken, don't try and mend it. And you've got to bear in mind that it's, you know, it's a risk of upsetting the bladder and triggering off a fresh UTI, or even pushing in another bacteria. You've got to think that the majority of UTIs are caused by bacteria that are already within the urethra. And you can clean as much as you like outside the urethra and the vulva before you insert the scope. But if you're going to be pushing a fiber optic scope up a urethra that has uropathogens, UTI causing bacteria sat halfway up the urethra, they're going to be pushed in. So I also would advocate that if you are having one of these procedures, that you always ask for antibiotic cover.
Okay. Sure. And is it known whether Hiprex is safe during pregnancy or for use for children?
Okay. So unfortunately, it is not safe for use in pregnancy. It's not recognized as being safe for use in pregnancy. So we do take our pregnant ladies off it.
Okay.
It is safe for use whilst breastfeeding. And in terms of children, we can use, I certainly prescribe Hiprex for children over the age of 12.